That's making it. I don't care what you do. I've been really, really blessed. You know what I mean? I've been blessed. And the only way that I got blessed was...
Take more.
God, I hate saying this. Dates. I hate dates. Because everybody starts like, well, wait a minute. Wow, he's old. In 1969, I got out of prison. And I was not a very nice person. You know, I just, in prison, you don't have any classes on how to be a nice guy. You know, you just kind of put a murder face on and do the best you can. And I had a sponsor that told me, Danny, you have two problems. And I said, what's that? He said, one, you're not a nice guy. Two, you don't even look like a nice guy. So you can't fool people. And here, somebody can just get this away. I'll be playing with it all night. nothing sharp or shiny. They don't even have nothing sharp. I said, what do I do? This guy's name was Sam Harding. He was from Kentucky. He had did 15 years in the penitentiary for, he called it an argument. Everybody else called it murder.
Should we be laughing at that?
He said, you have to start doing things for other people and not even let them know. You have got to learn how to do things, because you got to remember, being a prisoner, being in prison means self-centered, egotistical. You've got three mindsets, that's it. I will either intimidate, manipulate, or fantasize, that's it. It's kind of the same thing as a student. Intimidate, manipulate, or fantasize. That's all I do. That's all I knew how to do. I did not know how to communicate with anybody. We didn't even say hi. In fact, a lot of people today don't even say hi. It's like most people used to say, hello, good morning. Now we just go, That's it. That's communication. And we've turned a whole sentence of good morning, how are you, into so. That's it. So, that's it. That's all. No more. So. And obviously nothing's up, because nobody ever has it. That's it. Walk away. I had to learn how to actually say hello to people. Because I didn't. I gave people a dirty look. You know what I mean? And I had to say hi to people. Because I do. And people, a lot of times, will look at me and immediately put on an ugly, what I call ugly face. You know, because it's like, not that they're intimidated, but that's what I made a job of, intimidating people. You know, that's the way I survived. That's the way I stayed alive, was intimidating people. And having three killers with me always helped. So I had to start saying hi to people. And if you can imagine, here's this tattooed guy standing around, and somebody looking at him, and he going, hi. They don't know what to do.
Get the fuck out. Poor job sandwiches.
What they saw was this guy full of tattoos that looked intimidating, and so immediately, and I go, hi. Computers. If I would have gave them that dirty look, if I would have tried to be intimidating, that they understand. People understand that. Act accordingly. I started trying to do things for other people. And this is the one thing. I'll tell you, I always mention God. Some people get offended, I'm sorry. But saved my life. I was so angry at God, all right? First of all, I'll give you some good reasons. I wasn't born one of the Gettys. Or the Hiltons, and, you know, and you know, my parents, hardworking, you know, and I wasn't a great athlete. I was a good boxer, but I wasn't a great athlete. But they don't have, like, boxing in junior high, high school. I had it and got kicked out a lot because of it. And so, you know.
That wasn't a joke.
I was, the way my life was, I kept going to jail, I kept going to jail, and I kept blaming, you know, God for it. And so the last time I was in prison, I had it with me, you know. Thank God he didn't have it with me, but I, oh God, man. Shiny stuff. I dedicated my life to helping other people, and I consciously, you understand? I didn't know what to do, see? I was in the hole. I went to the hole in prison May 5th, 1968. Cinco de Mayo, which is a Mexican holiday. Everybody thinks Cinco de Mayo means 5th of May. But to a real Mexican, it means get bail money. Going to jail. I was in prison, and me, Ray Pacheco, Henry Quijada, did some real serious offenses and went to the hole. And basically, we're waiting to go to the gas chamber. I remember praying, and I remember saying, God, if you're there, me, Ray, and Henry will be all right. If you're not, we're screwed. I swear to God, sorry. And for some reason, I just didn't feel hopeless, and that's the way I always felt, hopeless. I was a big fish in a little pond, and I knew as long as I stayed there, I could continue to be a big fish in a little pond, which was prison. What happened was like a miracle. The people that we hurt, which one of them was a free guy, which is not smart if you're in prison to hurt a free person. And wouldn't come back into prison and testify, left. So the district attorney didn't file charges on us. So I had to finish my top, Ray finished his top, and Henry finished his top. Ray and Henry both died in armed robberies. Separate armed robberies. Prior, I mean, you know, shortly after, a couple of years after they got out, I got into a 12-step program and just started helping people. That's it. That's all. Ridiculous. Because you gotta remember, I wouldn't lift a finger to do anything. I was very, very self-serving. If you ask me, even if a teacher asked me, could you take out the trash? Can I get extra credit? I'm gonna get paid. Can I get extra credit? Well, no, then take out your own trash. I remember standing in front of my mom's yard, and I'm looking down the street, and now you have to understand, I grew up here, I robbed everybody on this street. Nobody likes me. And I'm seeing this lady, and this is back in the 70s, early 70s, and she's pulling out with a big trash can. This is before they had the rolling kind, that big tub. And I watched her, and I went over to help her to pull it out. I said, that's what I'll do. I'll be nice. And I went over, and I remember saying, no, no, rob me, don't. Shut up, lady. That's what I'll do. There's a lot of old people in my mom's neighborhood, so Every like Wednesday or whatever it was, I would go and I would just take out their trash for them, you know. And I remember my mom saying, remember that little man down the guy with the little bad arthritis? He brought you, said, gave me a suede blazer, which was real popular. And he said, okay, so good things happen. Everything good that has happened to me has happened as a direct result of helping someone else. Everything. Me and a kid named Danny Levitoff started a gardening business when I first got out of prison. And Danny was like the salesman. He could go to the front door. I couldn't go to the front door. He could go to the front door. They're blind. I can't. Hi, would you like us to mow your lawn? And they would go, sure. Okay, do you have a lawnmower? No lawnmower. I had a 65 Mustang. This was 1970. No lawnmower, nothing. You know, and if they had a lawnmower, then we would go down the street. And this is the way we made a living. It was like, and there was this one lady, this kind of crazy lady in the neighborhood, and she was actually a witch. And she turned all the kids into cats and stuff. But we would always go mow her lawn, you know, because she was like, I think for insurance. You know, I don't know, she wouldn't turn us in. We knew it. She had had one of her sons had died in Vietnam, and another one had died in a gang war. So she kind of drove her nuts, you know. So we would just go mow her lawn for her, just to mow it for free. We'd just hit it real quick and you know, rake up the leaves and leave. And we'd always see her at the window, looking at us. You know, she never, you know, she couldn't come out because the witches like burn out during the day. And while we're mowing her lawn one day, see, this guy comes over and he looks at us. Hey, yeah, he says, what are you charging the lady? My dad, nothing. She's crazy. Come on over. I want you to look at my yard. So he comes over, he's pointing out this. And the real gruff kind of guy. Well, you tell he probably worked construction. I want this done there. Hey, and I want that edge too. You know, oh God, I already hate this guy. You know? And then he goes to the garage and he lifts up the garage door. And he's got all this gardening equipment. I mean, like real gardening equipment. You know, like me, that kind, not that. And he says, look, I'll give you all this stuff if you take care of my yard. And I mean, this guy's got edgers, wheelbarrows, tools. We didn't even have a lawnmower. We didn't have an edger. We literally went from non-gardeners to gardeners with equipment. We got so much equipment, we went and bought a truck. You know, and got shirts, green shirts with like a little lawnmower guy running. Everything good that has happened to me has happened as a direct result of helping someone else. If I wouldn't have been cutting that lady's grass, this guy would never come up to me. And he's like, that is the exact way my life has gone. It's getting out of prison. I found out that helping other people is God. That's God. That's what this thing is all about for me. Do you understand? That's what it's all about for me. It's about doing his work. That's his work. I didn't know that. So I get into helping young kids. They start kind of gravitating toward me. And I'm thinking it's because I'm such a dynamic speaker. And my sponsors are, they like your tattoos. And, but we started this group and all. It's called, this thing called RIF, Recovering Independence and Freedom. And all these young people were coming and staying clean and staying sober because they liked hanging out with us, I guess, you know. And I remember a guy named Gene Lukakis, who had been about 14 years in prison, who had said, we cannot embellish our stories, because if we embellish our stories, these kids will start thinking, oh, I have to do this and I have to do that. We have to talk about the fear, the self-loathing. We have to talk about that stuff. See, wow. Can I just talk about killing someone? No, no. But all of a sudden, we're like talking about the loneliness of prison. Not, you know, not the thinking how tough we were, you know. We're talking about the sadness. We're talking about all the hurt. We're talking about the time, how you feel just before you fall asleep. See, because you keep a good front on all the time just before you fall asleep. And everybody in prison, just before they fall asleep, the thought is, gee, I wish I was home. At one little spot. And everything good that has happened to me has happened as a direct result of helping someone else. Everything. People always say, how did you get into the movies? I got into the movies by accident. Complete accident. I was a counselor for a place called Western Pacific Rehab. And I was working with this little kid. I didn't even like him, a little rich kid. Dad gave him everything. I remember him telling me that he said, I've been clean 8 days and my dad gave me my car. Oh, shut up! my dad hadn't talked to me for 7 years. But this kid, he was real enthusiastic about being clean. So I started like helping him, being his sponsor in a sense. And one night, calls me up and is in tears about 11 o'clock at night, and he's literally and I'm thinking, I was living alone at the time. I used to get some weird calls, so you want me to get undressed? What is it? And it's like this kid, and he's crying, and he's saying, Danny, I've got 108 days clean. My dad's renting me an apartment. I'm doing so great, but there's so much blow at my job. And I said, well, come on over. And he said, I can't, I'm working. And what I do is I hang out with people that want to stay clean. So I said, well, you can't come over. What do you want to do? Can you come down here? And then he did that thing that my daughter does. Every time she wants something, she does this little thing, this little, a little bit, let me see how I do. Here's the money. It's like, I'm a sucker. And I heard it on the phone. I said, okay, where is it? So I went down to hang out with this kid at his job. I was a counselor for Western Pacific Rehab. I'm making, I don't know what I was making, not much. Making a living. And I go down to hang out with this kid. I'm thinking it is a regular kind of job. I walk onto a movie set of a movie called Runaway Train. John Voight and Eric Roberts. I thought it was the cutest thing I've ever seen in my life. All these kids were running around in prison blues pretending they were like prisoners. And I'm looking at them and I'm thinking, God, this. You have a little trouble in jail there, buddy. You know? And they all got these fake tattoos on. Like, everyone, oh, I'm sorry, I got scared. Everything's smeared. And so this guy asked me, he says, do you want to be in a movie? And I said, what do I got to do? He says, do you want to be an extra? I said, extra what? He says, can you act like a convict? I'll give it a shot. That was a joke. I've been in every prison in the state of California. And they gave me a blue pants that I put them on, and then I wear them well. They fit well. And then they give me that blue shirt, so I took off my shirt, and I got that big tattoo on my chest. And I'm there without a shirt, and this guy comes over, this guy, older guy, and I'm looking at him, I said, I know this guy. Says, you're Danny Trejo. I said, yeah. He says, Danny, I saw you win the lightweight, the welterweight title up at San Quentin. I go, yeah. I said, you're Eddie Bunker, I know you. And we started talking. And he said, "Do you want a job?" I said, "I got one. They're going to give me $50. Right there, like a condo. "No, we need somebody to train one of the actors out of box." And "What's it pay?" And he says, $320 a day. I said, "How bad you want this guy beat up?" "I was making $320 a week before taxes." "Just $320 a day." And I says, "Well, you can't hit it." I said, "Okay, well, pretending fight, you're gonna give me $320. You have to choreograph it." "Okay, what's that?" "You have to fake a fight." "Okay, I'll do it. So all of a sudden, I'm training Eric Roberts how to box. And the director saw me, and he saw that Eric was afraid of me. But he wanted to learn how to box, so he'd do anything I said. So we have this training regimen. So the director hired me. He said, "You'll be in a movie, you work with Eric." So I started working with Eric Roberts. Me and this kid hung out together. He stayed clean. And I'm in a movie called Runaway. You have to remember, this is 1985. Now, in 1985, you could walk into any production office in California or anywhere, and you would see lines of cocaine. It was crazy. It was insane. People used to walk around with little coke spoons, just doing blow. It was fashionable. And then that was 85, then in like 1989, everybody was in rehab, Oops, oh, it is addicting. They lied. So everybody left us, But so I started doing film without even wanting to. It's like I was on this movie and I made friends with people. And they, "Hey, Danny, they're casting over here for this." And I'd go over there and all of a sudden I never had a name. The first 5 years of my career, I was only like inmate number one, gang member number one. I never had a real name. The first name I had was with Charles Bronson in a movie called Death Wish 4. I was Art Sanella. I'll never forget that. That was my first like real name, And then after that, it just kind of blew up. I started doing movie after movie after movie, and I've been really blessed, and I cannot forget that everything good that has happened to me has happened as a direct result of helping someone else. That's a God's honest truth. I produced a movie. Do I ever want to rent a good movie? Rent a movie called Animal Factory.
Yeah.
Willem Dafoe, Eddie Furlong, Seymour Cassell, Mickey Rourke, myself, Tom Arnold. And let me tell you something. There's this market in Los Angeles. It's out in the San Fernando Valley. It's called John's. And there's about five of them. They used to be Vons, but the Mexicans bought them, and they just took off the V and put the J. But you can still see the shadow of the V. I love it. You see the shadow of the V, but it's a J, right, John? And I was in John's Market, right? And I'm looking at something, and this lady is, she's got her shopping cart, and she's walking, and she's got two bratty kids. Rah, rah, the kids are like jumping all over, and one of them knocks over her purse, and her purse falls, and her wallet falls out. Her wallet falls out, $820. I'll never get, whoo, just one like that, like a deck of cards, whoo. And we have certain reflexes that we cannot help. And I just went, and I'm looking at this, like a deck of cards right there, and I'm thinking, phew. Now, once you start doing things to help other people, once you start accepting a certain way of life, and start saying, wait up, I love God. These people are on your shoulders all the time, and there's just like this little war going. I got this one guy. Whoa, he jumps up. Oh, we scored! Shut up! Don't say nothing. Look, act like you're buying some. Shut up, Daddy. Act like you're buying some. This other guy, right? He's like, yeah, that's what kind of punk you are, Danny. Go ahead, take that lady's money. Ooh, because that's what you really need. And he keeps on and on. And now, thank God, this guy wins most of the time. You know what I mean? Most of the time wins. And so I look at her and I see her. I see, because I know better. See, this guy, if I would have picked it up, this guy would have had a lot more power. See, if I would have went and got that in my hand, oh my God, you're pretty more pretty. So I said, hey, senora, your wallet. She came back, she hugged me, whole thing, and then she counted. I remember she got, and then she looked like that. Let me tell you something. 5 years later, I produced this movie. Totally forgot about that. Completely forgot about it. And we're sitting around, and this guy, this funding source, said, okay, Mr. Trejo, we're going to give you $3.5 million.